Welcome to the first episode of Dog Color Genetics. If you are joining from my previous Cat Color Genetics series, then welcome back. For those who have not seen my Cat Genetics series, one, you should watch it. Cats and dogs have very similar and different sets of phenotypes and genotypes. And two, welcome aboard. This episode will introduce us to pigment cells, basic genetic terms, and the different allele series. So for those who came from the Cat Genetics series, this is like a review, but I still recommend that you watch this introduction video. I'd also like to point out that I will be teaching you with the help of an amazing website that is helping me learn about dog genetics too, called doggenetics.co.uk. Check it out for yourself. I will warn you, if you do not understand genetics, this site will be very confusing. So, we will start off this lesson with learning what the two different types of pigment is that creates fur colors in dogs. Pigment gives what gives skin, eyes, and hair their color. There are two pigments that create all colors in dogs. These are red and black. And if you came from the Cat series, you know that this is very familiar. Eumelanin is the default pigment for black. All black areas on a dog is caused by eumelanin, but there are genes that can turn eumelanin into other colors like liver, which is brown, blue, which is gray, and Isabella, which is pale brown or like a lilac. If the dog has any genes that turn its black eumelanin into liver, blue, or Isabella, then all of the black in its coat will be changed. A dog cannot be both black and blue or black and liver. Eumelanin also affects the dog's nose and eye colors. The nose will be black, liver, blue, or Isabella depending on the fur color. The brown eyes that most dogs have are caused by black eumelanin. But when a dog has altered and restricted productions of eumelanin, the irises will become lighter in an amber or golden color. The other default color is pheomelanin. This is the default red pigment. Red covers everything from deep red like Irish setters to light cream and even pure gold, yellow, and orange. Pheomelanin is only produced in the coat and does not affect the eyes and the nose. Unlike eumelanin, it doesn't occur in two distinct colors like black and liver, but rather just one color which varies in intensity. Most dogs have both eumelanin and pheomelanin in their coats. How these two pigments mix in the coat is controlled by the agouti locus in dogs. So what about the white? White isn't a color, but a lack of pigment, both in eumelanin and pheomelanin. Sometimes albinism can affect the dog, and sometimes just part of it are affected like dogs with white markings. It can also affect the eyes and nose, turning noses pink and eyes blue, or pink in true albinos. There's another type of white, which is caused by dilution of red pigment, making the cells produce fewer pigment particles than normal. If it is diluted enough, it will become white. Many dogs will have a slight cream glimmer in their coats because of the red pigment. This sort of white does not usually affect eumelanin, so any black or liver, etc. areas on the coat will stay dark and the nose and eyes will stay dark as well. So color genes in dogs do two things: determine eumelanin and pheomelanin colors and shades, and they control the distribution of these two pigments. It tells certain cells to produce melanin, produce pheomelanin, and sometimes not to produce pigment at all. Hair can grow banded with black and red. This is called agouti. It can also occur in dogs, but is fairly uncommon in most breeds. It comes directly from wolves, which can be known as wolf gray. Now let's also learn about genetic terms I'll be using throughout the entire series. Those coming from my Cat series will know these terms, but it's always good to go over these terms. Firstly, let's describe what genes are. Genes control everything about a living creature, including how it grows, how it develops, how it functions, and how it looks. It's a set of instruction within DNA which tells the cell how to produce their proteins, or pigment in this series. The genetic makeup of a creature is called genotype. Alleles are different variants of genes. They come in pairs, one from each parent. When I write and talk about alleles, we use letters to denote them. Genes are tied together in a strand of DNA. Each point in this strand is called a locus, or loci for plural. Each locus contains two alleles that form a gene. A series can contain a number of alleles in a locus, around 2 to 5. While a genotype is a genetic makeup of an organism, phenotype describes the effect of the genotype on the look of the organism. For example, when I talk about a black dog with white markings, we're talking about its phenotype. But when we talk about a big K, little K, S with a little I dog, then we are talking about its genotype. Every dog carries two alleles in each locus. Only one of these alleles is generally expressed. Which of the alleles expressed depends on dominance. The most dominant allele will always be the one expressed in the phenotype. A recessive allele is one with less dominance. Dominant alleles are generally written with a capital letter. Recessive alleles are written with a lowercase letter. Sometimes there is more than one dominant or recessive allele in a locus. When this happens, there is usually an order of dominance, so one of the dominant alleles is more dominant than the other, and one of the recessive alleles is more recessive than the other. A dog with a big B genotype has two dominant alleles, so it will only express B. A big B, little B dog will also express big B because big B is dominant over little B, and little B is the only genotype where the dog is expressing little B. It's also good to mention that sometimes both the alleles of a locus will be expressed. This is called incomplete dominance, or codominance. The dog will have a mixture of the two alleles, but its markings will generally lean towards the more dominant allele. Lastly, we'll talk about heterozygous and homozygous terms. A heterozygous pair of genes is one where the two genes are different. A homozygous pair of genes is one where the two genes are the same. So how do we determine how genes work with each other? Well, we will use a Punnett square. There are two rows and two columns. The alleles of one parent goes here, and the allele for the other parent goes here. We just put one gene letter in with each cell. Each of the four cells in the Punnett square represents one possible puppy phenotype. To figure it out, we trace up from the cell to the column and across the row. Now lastly, we'll describe what each locus will focus on in each episode. The A locus focuses on the agouti series, which affects distribution of both eumelanin and pheomelanin. The B locus focuses on the liver series. The D locus focuses on dilution series, affecting the intensity of eumelanin. The E locus focuses on the extension series, which affects the distribution of eumelanin. The G locus focuses on the graying series, which affects how eumelanin keeps its intensity over time. The H locus focuses on harlequin series, which modifies merle. The K locus focuses on the black series. The M locus focuses on the merle series, which affects the intensity of eumelanin. The S locus focuses on the white spotting series, which affects distribution of all pigment. And the T locus focuses on the ticking series, which affects distribution of all pigment. Well, that is our introduction to the dog series. The next episode we'll talk about is the K locus and the A locus. The fun thing about this series is that you can learn what your own dog's genotype is. I can't wait to see you for the next episode.